Okay, so let me remind you. So this is a basic inequality which I want to explain, but I want to remind you get the basics about von Neumann entropy. Which is one of the parts of the formalization, but von Neumann suggested for quantum mechanics in context with Hilbert spaces. And so, which we turn somewhat, presents very differently because we emphasize not so much operators, but rather quadratic forms on a Hilbert space, which are just functions, right? To real. But they're quadratic, they're special kind of functions. And this is a, and this function you can integrate. So the measure or density state is something, so this quadratic form that allows you to evaluate subsets. So measure is function on subsets. And so the subsets it's being applied to because they're in a Hilbert space. And this is being applied to subspaces, yeah. I'm not sure the meditation can read to what's written there, yeah. I think the S and there are subspaces T. This would be my Hilbert space, yeah. And when we have a subspace, you want to make sense of this quadratic form attached to T. And what we do, we take this quadratic form, we restrict it to T, so it becomes now a quadratic form in T. And we take the trace of it. And trace, see, it depends on the Hilbertian structure. Right? So in operator language, when you have a self-adjoint operator associated to a quadratic form, you can take trace. You can take trace without appeal to the underlying Hilbertian structure. On the other hand, what you cannot do, you cannot restrict to subspace. You have to do some tricks and just it's not a function, right? A restriction is an operation requiring, it depends on the Hilbertian structure anyway. But in this terms, things are kind of easier. So it's a function, it's a trace. And so what is a trace of a quadratic form? There are several ways to define it. And one is this kind of pure algebraic. You choose a normal frame and you summate the values of the quadratic form on these unit vectors of this frame. And again, the answer doesn't depend on the frame by Pythagorean theorem. Or if you don't want to choose a frame, you can say, I just restrict it to the sphere, look quadratic, the quadratic form as function on this union sphere and integrate all the sphere in the Haar measure, which is more symmetric somewhat, but the answer is the same. There are many ways to do it, and again, this is a remarkable circumstances depending on the Pythagorean theorem, without which, of course, there would be no quantum mechanics in this world. But then, of course, the point is that when you work in this Hilbertian setting, there is no kind of simple kind of category when you can do it. It's unclear what is the correct category. So what corresponds to maps between sets. There are two classes of maps, of course. There are embedding of Hilbert spaces, there are orthonormal projections, but they don't quite categorical. Actually, in the measure theoretic setting also, there was something not quite right in what I was saying, because besides category of measure spaces, there is a particular relationship between the category of measure space and category and this topology, category of topological spaces, right? Because you can consider the kind of natural map from measure spaces to topological spaces. That what people sometimes call random variables, which is extremely confusing language, yeah, which when you suppress domains and the range and it's just everything to confuse you. But this category has, it's not quite kind of categorical. It's kind of, it's not that it's goes beyond true categorical theoretic language, but it must be somewhat ornamented with this particular condition. Yeah, I don't know what that kind of abstract expression of that. So it's kind of two categories interact with each other. And in for finite sets, for finite measure spaces, you can your axes are just also finite topological spaces. But there are two points in there. Now, what is entropy? So, and so it may be, so the entropy, which is, it's a function. It's a function on a sphere. It's a quadratic function, and the entropy, the way maybe you want to define it in the most general term, traditionally, and it corresponds to the formalism of phenomenon in quantum mechanics. What you do if you have a quadratic form, and this density state. So the density meaning the trace is one. So the whole space has this measure, so to speak, in this sense is one. But you can always write it in diagonal form. It will be sum of some constant, and here form of rank one. And the standard form, there is projections on the axis, right? This, by the way, again, quite general. Point, so there is this basic form on the Hilbert space, which you can call one. If you take this form itself, it's not a density state, because the sum, the trace of the form will give you dimension of the space. And this, by the way, already makes the whole thing slightly more delicate for infinite dimensional spaces. You don't have the background, you can normalize it. But this will be this normalized background state, so it's diagonal form is everywhere. And so, and on any Hilbert form, there is preferred quadratic form. On any Hilbert space, there is a distinguished quadratic form. Now you have a linear subspace, you restrict this quadratic form, and when you project it, you can pull it back by this normal projection. So, and these are very special quadratic form of states, which we call subhomogeneous. They're almost invariant and almost full symmetry, certainly, that you cannot equate value here and value here. Here is zero, right? And here is some, it's maximum value. But apart from that, the as homogeneous as possible for this for states which have not maximal rank. And this is a difference, and as I was saying several times, is essential. In the classical case, you can do the same. You have a measure. You have a big set, and you have some measure, and they can average over symmetries. And what you have, a measure supported on some subset where it will become constant. But it will be zero here. But you don't have to do that. Yeah, in classical thing, you just array this zero. Right? And so when we define entropy, you have this homogeneous measures which have equal values at all atoms. And here it's kind of not quite so. I mean, just you can do it, but then you will be unable to prove what you want to prove. And apparently, it's physically questionable. You cannot restrict to subspaces in quantum mechanics without losing something. Kind of. So, but anyway, there are distinguished states which you project here. In particular, when you project the axis, you have states, kind of, they're called sometimes pure states, corresponding to rank one form, quadratic forms. And just let me remind you that these pure states, if you have this Euclidean space, it's our Hilbert space, but it's, you may remember, it's just Euclidean space, or certain dimension, these pure states live in the symmetric square of that. And this is so-called Veronese variety. It's a projective space embedded into the space of quadratic forms. It has dimension by two less than the space. So this is, if this is dimension n, this Veronese variety, I think, will be like that, yeah? I mean, sorry, space quadratic form will be like that. And Veronese variety will have dimension minus two. It's lying, it is projective. Topologically, it is a Veronese variety, it's projective plane of dimension n minus one. I'm sorry, it's lying in a dimension n minus one, it's lying in the hyperplane here. So it's lying in this hyperplane where it is really, cannot be, it's not lying in any small linear space. Two m's, I'm confused because you subtract one here and one here, they're two different ones, but they don't add up. So, and this is a space of all pure states. This is where there's variety, and everything else is convex combination of them. And again, this is a kind of a most remarkable convex cone. So usual probability theory concerned itself with this convex cone with just positive vectors, that this concern itself with this positivity, where extremal points are not in discrete set, but they make projective, plane, and they're kind of related and possible relation formal coming that one permutation group is a wild group of the orthogonal group, but I don't know how far you can go with that yet. So if this is a true relation, or it may be just slightly accidental, if you can use other series of classical groups. But anyway, that's what it is. So, and then any form can be diagonalized. So, and this I rank one form, density states. And this, and then entropy is by definition, so then these coefficients make a measure. So this become probability measure on the space of indexed by the spectrum. And it has entropy, and this entropy is declared to be entropy of this quadratic form. But, and this is how you almost always in classical discussions how people do that. But if you're more geometrically minded, you certainly don't like the definition, because you have this sphere, you have this function of the sphere, which happens to be quadratic. But you want to have a definition which would make sense even if it's not quadratic. Now, then, of course, you use this quadratic, but still, it's kind of, because this on one hand is very kind of fast definition, you don't have to think. On the other hand, it's when you start proving theorem, it's not so convenient. And this is one of the reasons why the theorem, which I stated to you, it was 5 years, to took 5 years to prove. And that this super additivity and, you know, Elliot Lieb, you know, a super strong kind of analyst, it was really very hard. Really kind of tour de force of this kind of analysis. It was really considered a very difficult, kind of great breakthrough, difficult theorem. But as I explained, if you change perspective, you become more or less tautology. Almost tautology. And now, so that's, so in the way to define entropy, there are the quickest definition.
Excuse me, that's the question. So those forms of rank one, you also normalize them to have
The density states of rank one. So they rank one and then normalize to be really have trace one. So just dxi squared. Yeah. Okay. But I just hate coordinates because we need double notation. You see, just you have even triple notation, lots of. But the quickest definition is as following. You have this function of the sphere. You take any orthonormal frame, evaluate this function. You have now a bunch of numbers, positive numbers. Think about this measure. In the case of density state, this always sum one. Even if it's not an arbitrary function, you can normalize them. You have sum one, take entropy of that, and then minimize over all frames. And the moment you say these words, part of this immediately obvious, namely it's obvious the function is concave in the space of all states. Yeah. Because infimum, because usual entropy is concave, and this is essentially Shannon inequality, and we discussed it at length, very simple. And once you know, of course, what to do with this, if it's not that simple if you first encounter it. But anyway, it's concave, and therefore infimum of concave function again is concave, right? Yeah. It's still concave. And therefore, entropy is concave. And that, again, was a theorem. It was really an achievement by Lanford Robinson in 68, something 5 years prior to this big theorem of Lieb and Ruskin. But now, if you want to look at this from a different angle, so, you know, to prove it. So first, again, explain what subadditivity means. Yeah. So you have a kind of physical picture, which equally applies to classical and to quantum case. You have, a crystal, and you observe it from some part of it, and see a certain number of states. Namely, you just attach something covering some region, and you see something tick, 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 tick. And how many times this ticking per unit time, that's the number of states. Right? There's nothing else. That's what you observe, this tick, 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 tick. And then take another piece, and have another tick, 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 and you take log of this number, this entropy, and it is subadditive. And the reason, of course, subadditive, if you two pieces are very far apart, of course, they tick independently, and so the number of ticks just multiplies, and this will be just additivity, because you take logs. And again, I explained that logs come not that, it's not completely frivolous, it's just by you go from multiplicative to additive group. But if they come close together, some may be incompatible, right? So this tick, so again, you see what you observe, of course, not some number of states. You observe transition from one state to another state. It's another, by the way, point, right? You never observe a state, right? In physics, you observe quanta of light coming from you, or eventually, this I think the only thing you can observe, right? Though indirectly. You have something coming from you, and this results of changing states from one state to another. And then it may happen that some, these kind of, but still you think of them as states. I'm not certain that it changes much logic if you really remember the traces of movements within your system. Yeah, just kind of, there's a process how you go from state to state by some random process, which you think is random in classical case. So when they're close, they may interact, so the whole, some simultaneous ticks may be impossible, so you have inequality, intuitively clear whether it's classical quantum, and when they overlap, you have this and that. It's not intuitive at all that this strong subadditivity that tells you the total number, so entropy here is smaller than entropy of this, plus entropy of this, minus entropy of that. Yeah, this is stronger subadditivity. And this, however, true, and it's classical cases. Shannon inequality, basic inequality about entropy. And the same is true in quantum case. Though, of course, many things are not true in quantum case. Except you have to now define carefully what does it mean, this decomposition, and in case of classical space, something concerning measure being sitting in the product of two spaces. So this picture is implemented classically, kind of union of system, meaning their product. So I have product of two spaces, x1, x2, x3, or maybe, might we know, it was, it's sets, actually, set 1, set 2, set 3. You have a measure on this set, and which you can reduce to 1, 2, to 1, 3, and 2, 3. Right, you can project this measure on three different coordinates, and then you have this inequality of this for measures of these projections here. In the quantum case, what you do, you consider tensor products, and you have this quadratic form on this tensor product, and then you cannot project, right? Tensor product doesn't project. There is no way, unless you have extra structure, and which you haven't discussed at length, so I'm not certain we'll have enough time. It's written in the final version of my lectures. This exactly, this logic here, amazingly enough, kind of formal, this formalism is very similar to what happened in the genetics of Mendel. Right, you know, Mendelian genetics has basically the same, there's no Hilbert space, pure linear algebra, but essentially formalism the same. How you project tensor spaces, what are distinguished states, whatever. But maybe in a second I'll say something about it. But what you can do, how to produce, when you have a tensor product of two spaces, how you produce objects go from one to another, you have S1 times S2, and how we can go to one of them, yeah? Say to S1. There is no projection, but if there is quadratic form here, it can give you quadratic form here because you can take trace with respect to this variable. These people always say, which I don't quite understand what it means, but it's much easier to say I average with respect to orthogonal group action on this, but in this factor. So what I get will be something symmetric with respect to this, with respect to that, meaning constant or homogeneous form. Therefore, it will be tensor product. I'm sorry, if I wanted, it was stupid. Sorry. And therefore, it will be product of something here, tensor product of something here, and this canonical one form, canonical one, I mean, I'm sorry, this background form here. And this is a reduction, quantum reduction. Okay. So, and this is inequality. But now, what is the logic of the proof? Sorry, in classical case, we're reducing everything to homogeneous states, and here we cannot quite do it. But still, we can pursue the same kind of logic and say, aha, we can define entropy in two stages. So first, we do it kind of approximately, and then we do it sharply. And so we take your state P and take a high tensorial power now. So it will be now on your Hilbert space tensorial power n. And again, just applying the spectral picture, yeah, we say, aha, it become closer and closer when n goes to infinity to this, what we call this quasi-homogeneous state or sub-homogeneous states. So almost everything will be very well approximated by projection, by the form coming from orthogonal projection of some subspace. And on this subspace, it will be just multiple. It will be multiple of the Hilbert form. And in the classical case, we will, yes, the whole, and entropy is, we take log of this rank of this projection, and the cardinality is replaced by dimensions or rank of this projection, take rank, take log, divide by n, go to the limit. And of course, it's just reformulation of the classical thing, but the picture is different. And so to have some, the point now is that it's hard to use these dimensions. So if you try to prove the theorem in this language, so if everywhere replace this numerical entropy by dimension of these subspaces, I tried this actually, before I changed my mind. I tried it, it's become some geometric question about, you know, Euclidean space, some geometric lemma about, you know, 23 or 4 linears of space in a space, how they behave, and boom, I just couldn't prove it. It's become, for some reason, extremely, it was kind of as difficult as the original problem. However, there is another point you can make. Instead of emphasizing dimension of the space in where you project, you emphasize this number, so it's proportional to the background form with some constant, right? And this log of this number is just asymptotically, it's minus entropy. So it's a small number, right? Of course, it's less than one. Entropy is positive, and this number is less than one, right? Because it becomes spread. This density state in a big dimensional space, yeah, its particular value extremely small. So it's logarithmic, this number decays exponentially, in the limit properly normalized, it's certainly it's negative. So, and this what you want to exploit. And at that point, I want to make a little digression about entropy in the classical case, because there is yet another point of view on entropy classically, which is close to what I'm saying here. And so, but there is another way how entropy can be defined, and this is one of the ways, actually, Boltzmann was defining it. Boltzmann was kind of, I don't think he was defining explicitly, but certainly it was inside of his work. And this is as follows. This is what nowadays called large deviations. Actually, I never could realize, understand the history of that, yeah. Who invented that and who proved what, and just, you know, the major figure in the making big theory was Varadan, who developed general theory. But it's unclear to me who proved what, yeah. So what was known to Boltzmann, it was proven later on by other people, because much of this was done by physicists, by Boltzmann, Gibbs, and then in modern time by Lanford and Riel. And then mathematicians like Varadhan, and yes, and different people give different references. Yeah, so I don't know, but the subject is quite simple. In its simple form, and I'm, by the way, pretty certain it's not the right form, but still I say a couple of words, it's as follows. You have a space X. It's a topological space. And you have a sequence of measures on the space. Say probability measures, to be simple. So the example, kind of seemingly different from what we have here, and on which is from where theory kind of usually is people start exposing in textbooks, when you have sums of random, of independent random variables. And sum of independent random variables means that you have a measure on, say, Euclidean space first. And then you take, convolve this measure with itself n times. And then we apply to the scaling of this Euclidean space to itself by factor 1 of n. I don't know how it's called. So it can be divided by n. But dividing is, in a sense, you scale the space. So when you convolve it, it spreads, yeah, and become roughly like it spreads a lot. And you compress it back, and it starts sitting in a finite region. And by the law of large numbers, if it was kind of original measure had compact support, it concentrates to a single point. So this function depends, measure will be almost all concentrated near this point. And then it was sometime, you know, just say, I'm curious, people say, well, big discovery. Of course, everybody knew this, the law of large numbers, what happens near there. But people were kind of ignorant what happens here, which is, I think, completely absurd. I think Bernoulli perfectly understood it. I think from Laplace, whatever, I think they perfectly understood it. It was a kind of minor issue. The major, they were interested, of course, deviations. And here it was kind of negligible. And so what happens here? And this was essentially, you can say, this exponentially converges to zero. Of course, now it's in the point function, because measure could be discrete. So taking values, not very good. So you have to evaluate this measure in small neighborhood. But still, if you're away from the maximum, where it can give you the full thing, so near here, of course, this measure will be almost all measure with the law of large numbers. But if you go away from this maximum point, take any other point, except, and this corresponds, of course, to the average, center of gravity, center of mass of this measure. Take any other point, and this will be exponentially decaying. So you take this tiny little point, tiny little ball, take this nth meaning convolution, but what I said applies to any sequence a priori. Take it, and again, you want to go, instead of writing multiplicatively, so what would be, of course, right thing to do, but it's common to take log and divide by n. This is how it was done traditionally. Again, it has not obvious meaning why take log. I don't quite understand the meaning of this physically. So you say, oh, because one number is big, another is small. It's not true, of course. There's some logic in that, as you know, more profound than this kind of convenience of notations. And which is seen already, in particular when you go and you look at this matrix, like Fisher metric and its variations. And so, and then you observe this, and then you take this thing shrink to the point in the end. And then you make second limit. So first n goes to infinity, and then this little thing shrinks to single point. And then you have a function. If you're lucky, if the limit exists, you have a function r of this point, which is called rate. Or it's kind of, it's logarithmic rate of vanishing of this function. Function goes to zero very fast exponentially. If I take log and see how fast it goes. If, kind of, it may go, of course, with a different rate. But that's kind of that happens so often. And this is what was done by Boltzmann. And Boltzmann computed that, in fact, for independent random variables. And Gibbs computed that, and therefore wrote all these formulas which now kind of assigned to other people in the large deviation, particularly Boltzmann proven that if your measure was just sitting on the frame, on orthonormal frame, right? It was So it was a finite set. It's Euclidean space, and there's a measure sitting on the frame. Then this R at a point Q, so I want to think, so I have here this measure P. I'm sorry, no, sorry, PI. So I have one measure PI sitting on my frame of I vectors. And then I take, on this simplex, take another point and want to know where you converge here. So it will be point Q. And this will be what, remember, I defined. It will be entropy of this measure with respect to this P. Now, just remind me what it is. A priori, we defined entropy when we had P being just standard measure on integers, on finite sets, to each atom weight one, right? But now imagine I put here another kind of P, any other measure. In particular, this will be a probability measure. And this, by the way, is these measures are always non-positive, because when P is probability measure. So what you do? First, you observe that, so you have this now arbitrary measure. It's a continuous measure. So you subdivide it in small pieces, and then it becomes approximately becomes homogeneous. P measure becomes homogeneous, but with different scaling. And then, and when you multiply it by constant C, of course, this will add or subtract this log C. So you have to normalize it then to this measure being everywhere abundant computed. So another way to say it, this exactly actually was defined by Boltzmann, of course. And another way to think about that, you have this measure on, basic example was, you have a measure, probability measure on the Euclidean space. This is always probability measure. This doesn't have to be. So I have probability measure on the Euclidean space given by this function on the, on linear space. L, you take this to the power n. This goes to the power n. It becomes almost everywhere approximately constant. Take this level where it's with this constant, and take the volume of this level with respect to background measure here, and take log of this. That's the entropy. So it's exactly what the original definition of Boltzmann was, the most general one. And then it was specialized by other people, and then it was unraveled back by non-people who apparently didn't know about Boltzmann. It's unclear to me. I don't understand how it was, why terminology was like that, yeah, because it looks kind of there. It was this kind of loop of development and came back to Boltzmann. Yeah. And there were many, many names attached in the way. Yeah. And, okay. And so what Boltzmann proven that for this particular measure, I just have this. And this, if you look at the definition, which I gave, it's kind of tautology. You just count number of states here and there. But what in practice happens, if you think about the meaning of that, for example, when this is measure with all atoms being equal, it's formulated the following thing. You just consider this formally sum of, yeah, take this polynomial, here is I terms, take it nth power, and look at this by multinomial coefficients. So it will be n factorial divided by product of n I factorials, where sum of n I equals n, when n goes to infinity. So how distributed binomial coefficient, what is the rate, how fast they, when you normalize them, when you properly normalize them, how fast they converge to zero. So they're all big, you have to bring them to one simplex. So they would say for binomial, you have two coefficients, n factorial, and here it is n1 factorial and 2 factorial. They spread over interval from 1 to over n, this function. You compress it to this function of the unit interval. They still, of course, go to infinity. You normalize them. You take log of this. You divide by 1 over n, go to the limit. And so you have certain function in the interval. And it will be just entropy of this measure. So when this is atomic, it will be just entropy of this measure plus this constant term. Yeah, so it. And this was proven by Boltzmann. Of course, he couldn't kind of avoid proving this with all his business. Yeah, he was counting how many states of this configuration of atoms you divide in this and that. And certainly, I guess, he wrote billions of these formulas. Yeah. And for him, they were so obvious, he hardly kind of, I think so. I mean, I may be mistaken. I read him very long time ago before I understood anything of that yet. But anyway, the point is that now entropy is not defined via some cardinality, but actually via the value at particular point. And that is what is we shall be doing if to understanding this strong additivity. So now let me. Now we say in another word about the strong deviations. So the strong deviation, again, we have a sequence of measures on a fixed space. But we want to know the asymptotics away from the point where they concentrate. So typically they concentrate, all the measures concentrate here, and then something happens outside. However, in examples, which immediately comes to one's mind like a geometer, you never have the fixed space. Space changes along with the measure. And this is very typical. Simplest example would be we have spheres of dimension n with the AHR measure. So how measure is distributed there? Right? And if you took, for example, any ball inside of radius strictly less, some radius, fixed radius, but strictly less than pi over 2. Then this measure approximately, measure exponentially decays, and there is some rate of decay. But on the other hand, if we take any band around the equator, no matter how narrow, this measure converges to 1. So almost all measure will be there. And so if you look at this limit, yeah, it's kind of hard to say. In my understanding, it has not been done so far in this large deviation, you even cannot say what happens. But of course, it's not so difficult to say. You can develop certain language and say what happens and just describe what happens. And this is commonly used in analysis, though in geometric study of especially Banach spaces, where that language, however, is not used. A more subtle example, if you look at simplices. And so you want to know how. So when you look at the sphere from very far, what you see depends on kind of your point of view, what you measure. So you have kind of class of constructive functions which you measure, and you go to the limit. And this is, of course, in algebra now associated to what is called tropical limits. And another basic example is the simplex. Yeah. So how simplex look like? If you look at the simplex and go to the limit and where measure is sitting, yeah, and how distributed in the measure. It depends how you look at it. You may say it's kind of concentrated on there, or concentrated in center, and just to have good language for all of that, you need a proper large deviation theory language, which is not developed, for all I know. At least if you look at the internet, I have not found it. Much is known about that. Of course, there are lots of specific results how these things are being distributed. But now we come back to the now picture and try to prove this. Try to prove this reduction strong subadditivity. So the picture, yes, you have in mind is this. I think there are many, maybe there already, no? Is that entropy is defined when you take this very high Cartesian power. So entropy of anything of this P is seen when you take this very high tensorial power. And then in the limit, it becomes this quasi-homogeneous or sub-homogeneous. So it becomes proportional to something induced from orthogonal projection on the plane from the background measure. So it's either rank of that, or its rate of decay of the value of this quadratic form in here. And now the dimension is something global, hard to control, but the values are very easy to control. And so this is how you define entropy. But then again, in this language is not very convenient, and much more flexible language is. So again, I spoke to people. So this was conjectured, yeah, by and proven by Lieber-Ruskaya, and I said what during the summer there was a meeting dedicated to the, or maybe no, not this summer, it was previous summer, 73. So it was in 2013. So there is another inequality. That, which here it means the following. When you have a group, compare group acting on a space, it acts in quadratic forms, and you can average of this group. If the group is, acts by symmetries, by linear, it's linear group. If the group acts by preserving your background form, then of course it doesn't change traces, so density states remain density states. By concavity of the entropy, of course when you smear it around, it becomes entropy goes up. Like, you know, if you have single point, and this is your space, and you move it around to average, it becomes constant everywhere, of course it spreads, so entropy becomes bigger. So entropy, how much you spread? But minus entropy, what happens at every point? In the of course, when the things are quite homogeneous, one is reciprocal of another, as log. And it's reciprocal, before log it's reciprocal. And this log become minus. And then you have that. And actually, this is again, it's kind of, it is where I spoke to Ruskaya, and at some moment somebody arrived at that, and that from point of view of the people was a kind of a big step. And all computational for me is incomprehensible, for them was obvious, but that was a difficult step. Yeah. And on the other hand, if you're a geometer, immediately you come generalize to that, because you don't understand what trace is, yeah? So immediately you place trace, but what you understand is average. See, the difference is that average makes sense for all kind of measures, all kind of action anywhere. You don't need linear Hilbert structure. On the other hand, if you live in the structure, it never comes to your mind to do that because it's not there. It's just you work with spectra, right? That's exactly, we have different context, right? So when you start thinking about that, you translate the language, you know, and for this language, this is always there. But anyway, this is a reformulation of that, but the groups you have. So let me show you what is the group, and this in this form I want to explain it. So to what it you apply? Yeah, it's easier to look. Right, so you act by orthogonal group on each factor. And because this reduction corresponds to exactly to that, and this is just you reformulate. You have to be slightly careful, yeah, because there is an extra factor, because you multiply sometimes by standard with canonical form, which add log term to the entropy, but have to be sure it makes sense. So, and again, in the case of the usual Shannon inequality, when you have some measure here, you project it here and project it there. There reduction, you push forward measure. But what you can do, instead of pushing it forward, you can average it, say about group acting on these fibers, and then become constant each of them. And this has the same effect as projecting it. Of course, it's one functorially determines another, they are slightly different quantities, right? Because you have to add up before you go, but they're now equal. So this adding up corresponds to multiplying by a fixed constant. In computation, it becomes kind of very simple. However, there is a little difference, and that is what this averaging does. And now, so I'll describe the proof. And so the point of the proof is as follows. So you pretend, so all entropies defined by taking height and zero real powers and going to the limit. So in the limit, your states become approximately projections induced by projection by orthogonal subspaces. And so you have infinite sequences, and in some generalized sense, in the limit, they become these subhomogeneous objects, They're not homogeneous, they're subhomogeneous, meaning they're induced by projection to these subspaces. But of course, subspace now infinite is kind of very high, large dimension on every step, and the value of the of your quadratic form become very small, right? So product of these values doesn't change. But, so to some logarithms doesn't. One is kind of reciprocal of another, and this it's one, yeah. But and this is how the kind of a specific value here can give you minus entropy, and the dimension of this give you entropy if you take log and then divide by n. But now you think in terms of kind of non-standard analysis. You say you just take this ideal limit and pretend the limit actually exists. And then everything reduces to the case when all states are of this type. And so, and when they're of that type, the proof becomes absolutely trivial. Because you just have to check something like A plus B equals C. Yeah? So let me write it down. It's so trivial, it's impossible even to say. I just show it to you. It just, it's absolute triviality. And here it is. I even don't know how to explain it. Yes, it literally A plus B equals C. So, but the ingredients that I wrote down because, yeah, so this is, yeah, compared to the Bernoulli and what I'm speaking about, this argument. Also, this argument which I described, and this power is, of course, extremely old and goes to physicists, and then it was taken by people in information theory, written absolutely incomprehensible terms, yeah. I remember you say, actually, I understood it trying to read one of these articles which people think if they speak about stock market, it become more transparent for mathematicians. Okay. So again, we have these states and just some language pictures to have in mind. Right, so every state has some rank, quadratic form has some rank, so it always induced by projection on some subspace. If it's maximal rank, the whole space. Otherwise, it'll be some subspace. And so there is this, here's maximal non-degenerate positive quadratic form, and the other induced by orthogonal projection. And this is support, and this is the kernel. So the support is perpendicular to the kernel. So zero is kernel, right? And so what we have to know about that? More? So if, in order to have the full measure, you have to take a subspace which contains this support. So all measures sitting in this support. If there is a subspace which contains only part of this, value of this density state as a measure of probability will be strictly less, again. It's just, there's nothing, yeah, it's just absolutely kind of trivial. That's the whole point. Everything, yes, yeah, I listed just to see what was being involved. So what else need? Right, secondly, that entropy now is defined by a single number when you sit in a support. Just this quasi-homogeneous states characterized where they are being projected, and this automatically gives this number. And this number is which we will be keep track of. We don't keep track of dimensions, right? And this, amazingly enough, is difficult. If you try to do it that way, look at dimensions, I just say, for some reason, I couldn't do that. Maybe I was kind of stupid when I thought about that. But with this, once I look at this number, things become absolutely transparent. And then they observe the following thing, yeah. That two, they don't separate properly here. So if you have two density state, two quadratic form, and one kind of both quasi-homogeneous, but one strictly big, not bigger than another, but has bigger support. Usually bigger support means it becomes smaller almost everywhere, right? So this must be kind of there's some confusion in words. So I have some form support on this line, and then I average it. And then it becomes spread everywhere. The trace doesn't change. But the value, specific values here, on this subspace, were bigger than everywhere here. So it becomes smaller on this support. But outside of support, it may become, it's not true anymore, because this was zero here, and this one will be not zero here. Right, so it will be say, 1/2 and 1/2. So this was 1 on here. After averaging, it will be 1/2 and 1/2. Right? So it was 1 here and 0 here. And then it averages like 1/2 and 1/2. So on this support, it becomes smaller. But outside of support, it may become bigger. Right? So that's, and accordingly, entropy is minus of that changes. Again, take Logan, who is changing, it's quite, if you say it in words, you are lost, but of course, computation is absolutely trivial. And this is what is said here. Of course, you can consider these ratios only if one kind of support of one is kind of one kind of engulfs another. So it's bigger in the sense of support, but smaller maybe, typically will be smaller in terms of specific values. And then, so this is what we use. Another property which we need, say when we average a form, its supports become bigger. Right? But it's kind of clear. Yeah, you move it around, average becomes spread. Yeah, I explained with the example. You have these points, you have a measure somewhere here, you move it around and take this average of all of them, it will be distributed to a bigger set. And so what this double average inequality says? It says when you start average something twice by one group and then by another group, and they commute, by the way. First, actually, I wrongly said that they don't have to commute. Don't have to commute, they still have a formula, but not exactly like that. And then on the second round, the way by how much it becomes smaller or by how much it spreads is less than the first step. The first step was crucial. And this is not surprising because first was most concentrated, so it's easier to spread it. And when it becomes bigger spread with the other group, it will spread less. Because space is this quasi-homogeneous, it becomes some statement about numbers. Essentially, the inequality which you use in the end of the day is that you have a quadratic form of certain rank, then its maximal value achieved on its support. Everywhere else it's smaller. And it's just all kind of algebra which you use. But then, for general inequality, it enters in some average sense. So. So this is, the average goes up. And then you can conclude to the proof. That this inequality, if there's subhomogeneous, and here is the proof, again, it's pure, it's kind of shame to write it even. Yeah, it's just so trivial that you wouldn't write it if it were not considered. Yeah, this is the inequality you have to write by how much thing changes. This is the value, but how it changes, they change by this ratio, and on the second round, it's smaller. You just have to want to think, to choose, you fix, choose any point where you look at this average, and then it becomes exactly what I said. Yeah. But this again, just if you look at algebra, it's quadratic form of certain rank, achieve its maximum on this support. But now, the point is, this is, yes, again, yes, we have to look at that, and just it's kind of really, kind of absolutely, provided you know your definition of a quadratic form, it's just completely obvious. But the point is how to use it for general case. This we use this homogeneous thing. There was only one number to look. Yeah, we look at one number, what's happening in this number, and you just become this computation at a single point, yeah, about two numbers. The question is how to make it a general. And here there is some. Yeah. Well, I don't want just you to no, just if you say it's obvious, it's much kind of easier, much better to swallow. And then we have to prove it in the general case. When space are not homogeneous, so they have lots of values, and when you go to this ideal limit, they become quasi-homogeneous, but this operation do not quite commute. Kind of the way you go to the limit, the way you average, they're not. They commute only up to error, which goes to zero all the time. And then I don't know how to do that without kind of really working a little bit. So because the corresponding formalism of this non-standard analysis in Hilbert space. So it seems there is a kind of this kind of non-standard Hilbert space, and there is a kind of a large deviation theory, but this large deviation theory will be even more elaborate than the one should be in the classical case. Even the classical case, in my view, it's just, it's not adequate for the purposes. And in Hilbert space, you have to look at simultaneous limits of several of system operators which may not commute, or operators, quadratic form, whatever you find there, you go to the limits, and then when you think of these terms, you realize entropy is a tiny little part of what happened there. Yeah, you have kind of lots of geometry going on, how things may go to infinity, and in different situation, exactly in Hilbert space, the limits will be of more elaborate nature, and some people do something there, but in a different terms. And this is, I don't know, I haven't tried to do that, but you can do it, just do it by hand, deciphering all I said, and then you have the proof. So it takes a couple of pages of two lines. I don't know how to do it in one line to make this non-standard language adequate. You just decipher, look carefully at all definition, and see everything fits. If you do it in the right order, again, I was spending some time, if you do it slightly wrong order, because things don't, different limits don't quite commute, you don't get the right answer. But I'm pretty certain if you formalize it properly and have this abstract formalization, everything comes by itself. You don't have to bother about that. Because there are about 5 points you have to adjust, and there are two variations in each of them. So there are about 32 variants how you have to organize the proof. And when I was doing it, the right one was the last one. So I knew I have to do it in certain ways. And just and systematically checking one after another, it didn't work. The last one worked. But it's absurd because I didn't understand, didn't get the right logic. If you know the logic, you immediately arrive at the right order. It's written in my article about entropy, and this is once it's written, it's kind of rather tricky. Yeah. And it's kind of like obvious, but finding that was difficult because it was stupid. But the question is if you can, it's worthwhile pursuing this non-standard Euclidean geometry. It will be generalization in a way, kind of far-reaching generalization of large deviation theory, but I don't know where it should be used because I don't understand even where large deviation properly used and what is needed for that. So it's such thing definitely exists, but it's unclear what to do with it. So, and now we make an interruption, and then we say something else. But again, it's not conclusive, yeah, because it's, the proof is, if you just, even what I wrote, is a little bit kind of technical. It's not as transparent as it should be, though it's very trivial by kind of, there's no technicalities inside. I mean, I repeat, all you use that quadratic, positive quadratic form achieves maximum on its support perpendicular to its kernel, right? And I don't know how to say it better. But I think one of the points, of course, it would be nice to prove something by far more general, and then become, of course, by far more obvious. Yeah. It still something is used, and because you have to, it's not incorporated into definitions. Okay. So I want to say a little bit more about algebra involved, yeah? And so when you go to Hilbert space, you find everything in terms of linear algebra. So on one hand, you generalize everything, and you replace, say here specifically, you replace the permutation group by the orthogonal or unitary group, if you go in a complex case. However, by the way, it's unclear what happens with these categories. So you might say, the category of finite sets replaced by some kind of category of Hilbert space, but there is no such nice category. But on the other hand, there are constructions in linear algebra unavailable in combinatorics, which allows you reformulate some of the theorem as follows. Yeah. So when you have a map between spaces, Hilbert space, you can induce quadratic form from one to another and look at the entropy of this induced quadratic form. And so you have speak about entropy of a map, or linear map. Once you do that, you can reformulate the usual additivity of entropy in the following form. So given now three linear form, which doesn't have to be positive or anything, any three linear form, and then it defines you two bilinear forms. So any bilinear form gives you a map. And bilinear form In Hilbert space can be thought as a map from your space to the dual space, because the Hilbert spaces you can induce this Hilbert form. And then there is this inequality. Ah, that doesn't quite fit, yeah? Yeah. Oh, it's okay, it's just brackets. And then, and this is certainly reminiscent of what I was writing in this algebraic terms of isoperimetric inequality of Whitney and Loomis-Whitney inequality. So these inequalities in turn, this basic inequalities between entropy, are in fact manifestation from certain point, from a geometric point of view, are kind of isoperimetric inequalities, and they related to them in the case of usual entropies. So let me remind you again this, which we had this Loomis-Whitney inequality was geometric inequality, and now I am going to formulate something linear algebraic, which is more general than that, by far more general, seemingly more general, right? So this inequality in the simplest case says we have a subset in three-dimensional space, and you consider three projections, plot 1, 2, 3. You project it to plane 1, 2, 2, 3, and 1, 3. And then the volume of this, square of the volume, less than product of these three areas. So it's very simple inequality, and it's stronger than up to a constant. It's qualitatively stronger than usual isoperimetric inequality. Quantitatively, it's not that sharp. And it implies all, at least in three space, all kind of so-called Sobolev inequality, including log Sobolev. And this, in turn, is consequence of this Shannon inequality for entropy, which is kind of weak form. And the proof is instantaneous with this definition of entropy. But it's exactly an example when you can think in these terms, it becomes obvious. And if you don't have this picture, it's really kind of a tricky to prove this, yeah, because it's, after all, isoperimetric inequality, even a non-sharp one, is a non-trivial theorem. It's kind of basic theorem in partial differential equations. You know, 90% of theorem follows from that, yeah. Plus, maybe even more. There is basically almost no any other non-trivial inequality there. The other is just straightforward integration. But then this has this amusing algebraic counterpart I'm formulating there, and this is as follows. So we have now linear subspace and the tensor product of subspaces. So I have Y. Let me see, I'm running a little bit ahead of myself. Yeah, so I have this, instead of geometric space, I have linear space, yes, linear spaces, take their tensor product. And so notation, yeah, you see just, I have the subset. This is kind of essentially, see if I, this is the tensor product of the part of this. You see, this is the whole point, you cannot put index. If you put dimension, rank of that, like you immediately get lost, yeah, so it's also tensor product of the power n is not correct notation, yeah. And so here is the situation. You have a linear subspace in this tensor product of spaces. And then you can kind of project it to subspaces. And again, you cannot project it, right? Tensor product don't project. However, you can say, aha, you take minimal kind of subspace in this factor, which gives you this space with tensor by everything else. So it's very similar to how we're defining this reduction in quantum case, in phenomenon case. But here we don't use unitary structure, it's purely linear algebra. So this is a kind of key definition. So we have a tensor product indexed by some set, we take a subset, and then we can speak about this reduction to this subproduct. It's not a projection of anything. And then there is the following inequality. I didn't plan to write this. Why it's here? So Now this was some preparation, yeah, just kind of justification with a set, forget them. So we have this subspace in this product. We project it to each J, and so we have the following simple formula. So this rank meaning dimension of my field, which plays the role of the volume. This terms rank of this projection kind of areas, and this product of these areas bound the volume, and here is condition of this alpha. This constant must be certainly not very big, yeah? And this, you remember, the square of the volume was product. Or if I take some volume, I would have to take square root of the areas to multiply them properly. So this alpha I must be properly adjusted, and this is called partition of unity, which is function on sets, on subsets with this property. So this is this kind of formula. And this is, in combinatorial case, it's called Scherer lemma, which, again, is a kind of, I don't understand exactly terminology, because certainly everything follows from Shannon inequality, and all Shannon inequalities are very trivial cases of Boltzmann inequality in the course of computation. Boltzmann contains all these inequalities. They're just implicit, I think, in every line of he does. But this is called Scherer lemma. And if you look at the textbooks, it's impossible to understand what it says. Yeah, it says something about hypergraphs, I don't know, some kind of fantastic language. Yeah. Yeah. But this is generalization of that, and this is kind of cheap generalization. It's very easy to derive it. On the other hand, it's much kind of indicator is built in linear algebraic kind of structure in there. And so this, I have an article where it's written. And this is probably the end of this linear. But what is unknown is, and this is also unknown for classical entropy, and this is unknown for Neumann entropy, what is the full set of relations between entropies of different sets and different projections, etc.? What is simple relation between them? So, and I think it's known that Shannon inequalities and this super additivity inequalities don't give you the full convex hull of all possible values of the entropy. They're linear inequalities on the entropy. So they define some convex set in the space of entropy, say, for different subsets. And here there will be ranks. Instead of that, they consider logs of ranks of different reductions. So what are all these relations? This is a question of polylinear algebra. And I think if you go deeper into that, which I couldn't, you arrive at really quite interesting thing about algebraic geometry. And so in this respect, so what you know, and why you think so, that if you look at the following question on algebraic geometry very much in the same spirit, you have algebraic variety in the product of two projective spaces. Yeah, so it's of any field, yeah, for that matter. So you have product of projective spaces, and you have algebraic variety. So irreducible, which, by the way, is essential. And you project it to A1 and A2 for two factors. And of course, this projection is pure kind of what involved over the complex numbers. And look at the degrees of these varieties. What is degree here, what is degree here, what is degree here? Properly understood, this for standard embedding probably. This, of course, not the sum. And then there is an equality between the two. So this degree bound by these two. And this inequality is exactly parallel and kind of implies it's equivalent in some trivial way to the Brun-Minkowski inequality. Because if you take this, variety, you divide this by action of maximal torus, they go to this kind of variety, something goes by moment map, they go somewhere, you look at this volume, see how many monomials are there involving in this degree, and this become kind of simple kind of tautology. It becomes Brun-Minkowski inequality, which is in a way generalization of isoperimeric inequality. So it's another kind of similar in spirit generalization of isoperimeric inequality from the one which I described here. And one understands this kind of the full extent of that, you know, if you just refine this inequality, and it becomes so-called Alexander-Fenhill inequality, which essentially amounts to Riemann-Roch theorem for surfaces for toric surfaces, right? So this relation between ranks, I'm pretty certain, if you go deeper, they reveal lots of interesting algebraic geometry, which I was unable to do myself, right? So this is why I bring them up. So I think there is extremely, extremely kind of interesting field there, which I couldn't penetrate, and I want to make some, before I come to the subject, which will be my last lecture, I want to retrieve my steps and explain something I haven't explained enough, namely how similar this algebra, so this is algebra of this associative probability theory, enters in classical genetics of Mendel, which I found extremely kind of, surprising when I understood it, because it's a mathematic as sophisticated as the ones here for Neumann, which was certainly not known anybody, not understood by anybody, and still not understood by biologists who do that. Here's a faster way to move it, no? Okay, maybe. Sometimes you manage to make it faster. Maybe I move it back here, and then I can.
Oh.
So I just, otherwise it would be too boring to move it. But I don't see how. Just 1 second, I want to come back to Mendelian dynamic. And we see, I'm using similarity with this formalism of Neumann entropy. But purely algebraic. One of the previous lectures said a little bit about that, but now I want to say more. But the same patterns there, but in some way different context. Okay, now, oops. Some reason I cannot do it fast on this. So I already was citing that paper by Hardy, and he wrote in 1908. It's about called Mendelian proportional mixed population. And so what he wrote? He speaks about this multiplication table, huh? Yeah. He said, yes, I want to. Yeah, that's exactly it. Yep. So he done it, and he just showing his being quite arrogant, saying, oh, this is mathematics of multiplication table type. And so what's interesting is everything hardly done. It's just, immensely less than this remark, because nobody knows hardly except a few mathematicians. Everybody knows what they've done in biology. He attached his name to really one of the maybe five or six greatest discoveries of science, which was a combination of thought and simultaneously having some implication. In the 19th century, there were only one comparable discovery, that was electricity. It was Faraday and Maxwell and some Ampere who were involved. There were several people involved, and that electricity was discovered, and our life changed. And another discovery was from Mendel, genomics, and our life changed somewhat later, partly because nobody understood what he was doing for about 30 years, and even Hardy didn't understand mathematics behind it. Biologists certainly were completely perplexed, And the story with Mendel, for me, is obvious, kind of. He knew mathematics. He was kind of mathematically minded man, and he wrote something. And he's shown to biologists. And these were great people, you know, scientists, famous people, leading biologists. When he assumed they understood multiplication table. None of them did. Actually, we know very well, say, Darwin, he couldn't add numbers. When they discovered geometric progression, for them it was, it grows fast. It was a revelation. Yeah, they didn't know the problem of Fibonacci rabbits, apparently. Yeah, for them, they never heard of that. Yeah, they referred to Malthus. Malthus never, by the way, never claimed originality. Now people are saying, Malthus said about exponential. It was known certainly before Fibonacci, and Fibonacci never discovered that. Of course, it was known to ancients. Yeah, and there are lots of literature written about that. And one of the most kind of interesting was here written by Condorcet, who analyzed before Malthus all the situation and said what should be done, and then Malthus argues with Condorcet. And everything so Malthus done, he says Condorcet was too idealistic, so he cannot control population. We don't know who was right, but mathematically, of course, there was no science involved. And then it was taken over by Darwin, and exponential function, my God, yeah. And this biologist seems kind of very much impressed because they don't know multiplication table. And inside of Mendel, there is much more sophisticated mathematics, and which hardly missed. And so I want to show it. It's very simple, very beautiful mathematics inside of this work by Mendel, which Mendel perfectly understood, of course. I think so. I mean, of course, Mendel was not writing about mathematics. And of course, and the major point of him, he had done this tremendous amount of experiments. He had very rough statistical data. And he used, on the other hand, extremely fine mathematics, which was completely kind of perpendicular to this data, because it was very fine mathematics and things were very rough. However, and he rightly concluded, that gave that conclusions, the existence of genes and the fact that organisms he was considered were diploid, like ourselves. So there are two sets of chromosomes. And he saw that, and this was never ever before, and I think never after done in science, that you can use, on one hand, very refined mathematics and apply it where it apparently doesn't work, but it still works. And interestingly enough, Fischer, who was following Mendel, thought he was cheating. Fischer didn't quite understand that, yeah. He was certainly a great scientist, but not the same as Mendel. Yeah, he has, a great mathematician. He didn't understand the whole logic of that. Yeah, he was a great admirer of Mendel on one hand. On the other hand, he believed that Mendel falsified his data, which was not the case. Because you see, statistics is a tricky subject, depends how you interpret this, how you derive data. But you see, if you a little bit go out of the average, a little bit, and it goes systematically in biology, it tells you something happening. It's not like in physics. In physics, you want constant being true up to, ninth sign. They're very proud of that. In biology, if something is true 60% of time, it's already fantastic because it's systematic. And that tells you there's some structure there and you can extract the structure. And this is what Mendel done. And then another instance of that was done by Sturcevant, another remarkable instance. But that kind of course, is. What he says is no big deal, but now this is, again, as you look at how much Hardy is cited for his mathematics and for the theorem on Google, you see this factor of 100 at least, yeah. And he was, by the way, not the first to do that. That was done by somebody, Castle, before him, and then was simultaneously by Weinberg, and it was, somebody told me, actually, I spoke recently to some biologist. And he said, no, but Hardy done so simply. It was so complicated before. The paper by Weinberg, when he was proving that, was about 80 pages. It was five lines in Hardy, but it doesn't need nine lines. It needs one line. I should explain to you if you say it correctly. It's line A, B, C equal how you put brackets on A, B, C. Yeah? That's all is involved. However, formally, this kind of identity involved. But what it expresses is, if you look at this map, and what Hardy says, but he doesn't say it in these terms, right? So I have this map. Then this map, if the thing p plus q plus r normalized to probabilities, so sum is 1, it is idempotent. So it's a very simple map. And so what's amusing about that, and indeed, it's quite incredible, you have polynomial map, you repeat it twice, and degree doesn't grow. Right? Yeah. Apparently, when you compose polynomial maps, degree multiplies. Sometimes things become degenerate. And by the way, many inequalities, like all these Shannon type inequalities and phenomenon inequalities for entropies, they say something doesn't quite degenerate. But sometimes that's degenerating. Something kind of paradoxical happens, and then biologists had hard time to accept Mendel. And it's, again, this big controversy why they couldn't understand Mendel. Yeah. So what was the problem? But I think it was just complete lack of mathematical thinking on their part. And then, so let's just, again, I repeat what I said last time. So we have diploid organisms. So each of us carries two sets of chromosomes, one coming from father and from mother. You know, there's a DNA each about 2 meters, by the way, DNA in each. In every cell we have about 2 meters. And they two. And so, and this was a kind of remarkable thing by Mendel, is what being inherited is not what you see, because it's function of two variables, but each individual variable being inherited. And that was absolutely kind of fantastic idea, which was, there was some precursor of that, there was the idea of Mempertti, who was saying very similar thing, but Mempertti was saying it incorrectly, but still the idea was there. But of course, little reason to believe that Mendel knew that, and he described it from there. And so, what is the statistic? Well, how probabilities come? First, they are not numbers. So because you can say, take how many whatever you have in population, and then normalize by the total number. You never can do that in reality because you don't know the total number of objects. You don't know how many genes are in population, how many animals. Still, you can work with probabilities, but they are ratios. And in fact, and this I will not have to time, partly because I don't know this well, understand myself, this whatever statistic you make, you never normalize. You have very sophisticated functions, sometimes more sophisticated than the ratio, of frequencies, of relative frequencies. And from this, you make conclusions, right? And this was actually how Hardy was writing very correctly. You have these proportions, they're ratios. You don't have probabilities. Yeah, when you apply it to real, and then you look at more sophisticated situation, there's something else. They're not proportion, they're somebody else, and the whole probability collapses. This normalization works in physics fantastically well. It doesn't work in biology, or in linguistics, by the way. And so probabilities are not numbers, they're points in the projective space, right? They only define up to the ratios. Even this is not quite correct because you don't know a set. Set I is unknown to you, and this again, in other cases, it's unknown and you cannot actually bring it honestly in the game. Sometimes you do, and here you don't make mistake. In many cases, like in languages, it leads really to actual mistakes. However, what's being done, so what you have this matrix, kind of distribution matrix, how many particular pair appears in population. But so each genes, each of them is a pair of two possibilities of the gene. The gene may be of several different kinds. There are, say, 10 different types of the same gene, and each of them of organism has one of those combinations. There are 100 of these combinations with certain probability, you say. But of course, probability must be understood carefully. And this is what actually Hardy was saying, that you can interpret these as probabilities. But they are in there. But then when there is random matching, so individual mate on random, there is a mixture of that. And this actually was the main point of Hardy, which he didn't say in this language. So what happens to this matrix? What is the operation? And the operation is as follows, yeah. This kind of segre product. You have a matrix, you take through given element column and you take a row, you sum up and multiply. So you sum mate here, sum mate here, and put back their product. And so we have quadratic map in the space of matrices. And what Hardy proven for a special case of symmetric matrices of rank 2 is that, so this is a formula. And then by just associativity of the product, all you use associativity of the product. I don't think even commutativity is used. That on the first round you achieve equilibrium. If you projectivize this map, this will be the same. And that's kind of very simple, but certainly it's not. There is no multiplication table in there. It's algebra. There is no numbers. It's pure algebra. It's much more primitive than on one hand. On the other hand, it has kind of interesting development. And so, if you restrict it to symmetric matrices, assuming that male and female population carry the same set of genes, everything will be symmetric. And so this map is just a retraction on the Veronese variety. Remember, we had this Veronese variety in fundamentally playing fundamental role in quantum statistics. So it is a cone of positive forms, all quadratic forms. Here is this projective space sitting into there. But amazingly, you can retract everything here. There is a kind of rational map. It's a retraction, meaning square of this equal itself. We can retract ambient space to this Veronese variety. And the fibers of this retraction are affine spaces, by the way. And this is a map which does it. And this is a quite kind of remarkable piece of geometry. Yeah. It has nothing to do with multiplication table. Yeah. It's a kind of nice piece of, but certainly Hardy was not a geometer. Right? So he has thought in formulas. And this is his mathematic, actually all his mathematic was about multiplication table. And this is why he, so his kind of arrogance I find rather misplaced. And so this preserved this and probability may be one that doesn't have to be positive. You know, it's pure algebra. But what I was saying last time, it's not surprisingly entropy goes down, goes up, so it spreads kind of features. But again, the remarkable thing is that it square is one. And people, biologists couldn't accept this. So you mix two populations. First, one become dominant, so one was dominant. You have more of particular species on the proportionally on the first round of interchange with them. On the second, nothing changes. So it completely kills the idea of evolution, how people understood it by Darwin and other people. It says no evolution, yeah, because arithmetic was against them. Of course, there was more elaborate in all respects, and evolution certainly there. And so, and these matrices which are of rank one are exactly those for which kind of they have this maximal entropy. So the equilibrium state and the states of maximal entropy, which is kind of very much in the spirit of statistical mechanics, statistical thermodynamics, and this was all in Mendel. And it's kind of shame said like Boltzmann, who actually entered the field in the same year when Mendel wrote his paper. So the thesis of Boltzmann was written in the same year when Mendel published his paper. But Boltzmann never read it. And this, if Boltzmann read it, would be, I think, the schedule of statistics would move by 30 years. So by now, maybe we have cure of many diseases, yeah? If it was, because he sent, stupidly, his article to biologists. He had to send to physicists, Mendel. And it seems he to talk to these people, he believed they understand something, and they are idiots. I mean, they're kind of very good biologists, they're great people, but they're idiots when it comes to thinking, really, in terms of mathematics. It's unbelievable. Actually, Darwin was not this, Darwin never read it, yeah. But we know that Darwin came across the same phenomena as Mendel, discreteness of certain features. And this was Mendel started, he observed certain features not mixed. You may have red and white flowers, you don't have them pink, yeah? You have either one or another in the mixture. And then he thought about it. And Darwin also observed that. But Darwin apparently rejected it because Darwin was obsessed with the idea of continuity. His major point in evolution was not people deciding evolution, selection, this was all kind of known. It was the idea that evolution is continuous. And this was principle of borrowed from Leibniz, in nature everything continues. And it was completely wrong. You know, the whole point of evolution is discrete. The whole thing of inheritance is discrete. Yeah? So everything, the key point Darwin's on emphasizing was nonsensical. However, altogether he was right. Yeah? That's interesting, get by the point. Everything he was saying locally was nonsense. But evolution was there and selection was relevant. But now, what is mathematics behind it? So this was kind of, this you have this, a linear spaces with extra structure, very little extra structure, which makes them much easier to handle. And this, you can, so typically they function on a discrete set, and you can sum up over this set. And this gives you linear functional there. And so a space with linear functions. So, and the example is this one. And of course, another example, exactly quadratic form operators, when there are traces. So spaces with traces. And when you have spaces with traces, I mean, just Very, very convenient. And I believe sometimes it's called vacuum state in physics, but I'm not certain. There's some distinguished state. Hilbert space, and Hilbert space, of course, dual vector covector is the same, but there is distinguished vector. And the whole point of the whole genetics invariant and the symmetry is preserving this, and the linear transformation preserving this covector. So it's you don't have permutation of genes or whatever, but you have the whole linear symmetry. All these formulas of genetics have this symmetry, and which makes this theory extremely elegant mathematically, but I'm saying extremely, when it's applied to real life, is only a little bit better than nothing, yeah? But this is a little bit, quite a lot, yeah, on the other hand. And then, in particular, you can have these maps from tensor product to each component, which usually don't. So you kind of have reduction. I don't know if it has anything to do with quantum mechanics. So there are the distinguished vectors. You say something is a vacuum, and you can kind of throw away some variables. But mathematically, it's very simple. Now, what is this map, next generation map? In this language, it's like the following thing. You project to each component, and then tensor back again. What can be easier, yeah? So this, you project it in this, and you look at this thing back. Now, how to prove its square is equal to itself? Because it is a tensor product of two elements, kind of pure state, what physicists say. It's a monomial object. And because it's monomial, right, it has this kind of monomial. So if you multiply it, so you need a multiplication table. You don't use addition here, you see? So what's involved? And because it's quadratic, this must satisfy this formula, because it's quadratic map. So you know what the normalizing constant is. So even without that, you know it will be preserving up to a constant. Map will be important already in the projective space. It will be important, and specific constant come because preserved. And so this is his multiplication table. Yeah. So it's really one line. Yeah, not nine lines. So now, if you look at so what happened there, and this is quite interesting that you have maps. So you have dynamics. There's some kind of distinguished maps. So this is instance of that for quadratic polynomials. That act in spaces of polynomials. And these maps have this kind of remarkable algebraic properties, that they are my square, maybe they may be important. Or some maps of this kind may be invertible. Polynomial map is invertible, right? And they all come along with Mendelian dynamics. And you know, the maps which are invertible, polynomial maps which are invertible, generate nilpotent groups. So nilpotent groups also here, but this is not essential. But the way you can see it, and this is actually this formalism that I'm describing isn't in Mendel, yeah? Also not, of course, not in these notations, that tensor products of spaces naturally embeds into the space of polynomials. Right? So you don't have to bother about this kind of abstract thing as tensor product, because you look for polynomial in many variables, and they're very special polynomials when variables are separated. Right? And so there is much, much more in there, but this is some part of polynomials. But this gives you very flexible language in there. And then this vector which we have corresponds to this covector evaluation of polynomial at a particular point. And again, what they do in genetics, and if you look at the textbooks, you see this kind of, they certainly never say it, there are some formulas, you evaluate at the point one, when all vectors are one. And this is inconvenient, because it's much more convenient to use point zero. And then point zero, all formulas disappears, and formulas are binomial coefficients. So usually when you see the text in genetics, there are lots of coefficients, but that because they evaluate polynomials at the wrong point. But they're all the same. This extra symmetry there, because in the space of polynomials, you have this action of translation of the background. And then, I want to give an example of some dynamics which associated with Mendelian dynamics, elaboration of Mendelian dynamics, when you have not one gene, but many genes. So in reality, you have many genes, and the stochastic process acting there is the kind of the probability space is the product of involutions. So you have this plus minus group of two elements and some power n. And on the other hand, you have n genes in another set of these n genes coming from father and from mother. And this group permute them on random. Some may permute it, some not. And this is called crossover or a combination, but crossover. So when a new kind of organism being created, new genome is being created, it creates out of old ones with some measure on this group. And the point is, irrelevantly of what measure is there, insofar it has a full support, so it mixes everything. The dynamic of this will be always the same. However, again, when you apply it to real life, it's unclear what it means. Yeah, it's, I don't know if it has any application, but mathematically it's quite amusing theorem, which is, so let me describe it. So what it says. So what are these maps which we described, this corresponding to this kind of random matching? So we have polynomial many variables, right? Space of polynomials many variables. So variables separated, yeah, they're groups of variables. So the maps are as follows. I restrict my polynomials to some plane, so it's a product of planes, yeah? So it's 2 by 2 by 2, so they're dot lines, yeah? And then extend it constantly outside. So it gives you endomorphism in the ring of polynomials. So I restrict polynomials onto the subspace, but then I extend it. And that's possible because this linear subspace, of course, is a retract of the big space, right? So if I have a function on the plane, and I have this line, I restrict it here and make it constant in these directions. Restricting is easy. Making constant along direction requires existence of these directions. And this is possible because I'm seeing this projection to the line. So there are this, and when I have many of them, I project to many of them and then multiply them back. And this is exactly what we had before, this picture we had before. Square of this map up to a constant is equal to itself. It's idempotent. And it's idempotent because projection onto the coordinates in the space are idempotent. Linear projection here, square is one. For that reason, this square is one. Right? So the computation of Hardigan amounts to saying projection square equals one in proper notations, right? But this is exactly the whole question about mathematics. It's not multiplication table, just write notation. And when you multiply them, by the way, yeah, when you multiply them, it will be not already endomorphism of this algebra of polynomial, but you multiplicative endomorphism, right? Because they're endomorphism of the algebra, we multiply them, it still remains endomorphism, but only multiplicatively. And so it preserves degrees of polynomials, and it's nice to think about that, not as a subspace of polynomials, but as it works in the space of truncated polynomials. So why it is, so what kind of advantage of that? So the ring of truncated polynomials is a very nice ring. It's a ring which has very good exponential function. Usually in most rings, exponential rarely defined. But if they're truncated polynomials, so it's meaning you take polynomials and all higher degree terms, you declare being zero. All terms with degree bigger than D, declared zero. So it's additively, it's the same as polynomial of degree D, but multiplicatively it has a little structure. But the point is, it has good exponential and good usual formula for exponential works, and it's invertible for all polynomials which start from positive term. If the free term is positive, it's invertible. So it's as good as it could be, like for real numbers. It has perfect exponential. So it suggests, by the way, that all we were saying about entropy and measure theory must have counterpart where you replace numbers by this kind of ring. This ring is as good as real numbers. And I think it's, again, one line of thought may be interesting in this, motivated by this Mendelian dynamics. Well, there are kind of trivial formulas, yeah. between these maps, but the whole thing which I want now to formulate where some analysis enters, so far is pure algebra, just elementary algebra. Still, it's rather amusing because some things secretly cancel there, right? For a very simple reason, but you have, again, polynomials where things happen. Yeah. So this is it. So what is the formula? So you restrict on the zero levels, on the zero planes, and multiply, and that will be the normalizing factor. And so these are polynomial maps. So in the space of truncated polynomials, these are polynomial maps which are multiplicative endomorphisms, and moreover, they are idempotent. Which is kind of the fact such thing exists, and a priori not at all clear. Yeah, it's rather, and they all, of course, and then that you can linear, these maps are non-linear, but they became linearized because of this very simple, exponential. They say they're multiplicative endomorphism, but because you can take logs, they become additive endomorphism. And for additive, things become kind of much more transparent. And so this map become linear maps, right? Because additive endomorphism of this algebra are just linear maps. So they're conjugate by exponential, they're kind of conjugate to linear maps. And this again, so this is a nice exponential. So just little propaganda for this kind of maps. And so they retract, of course, each of them retract to their respective Veronese variety, and the fibers of this retraction are affine maps. Because they have kind of behavior, why they're affine? Because of the linearization. If you apply this linearized map, everything, of course, the fibers always affine, but because they're linearizable, they will be affine. Right? So exponential, well, this, of course, you can see directly, but in this way, you don't have to think. And then, I want to give some offshore of that, what I was saying about genetics, what is the mathematics of that? So each of this of this map depends how you decompose a set of indices into different groups. So it's exactly how it happens to the entropy. So you have this state, you decompose in different things, you look at each kind of entropy, but now this, instead of entropies, which are logs of product of numbers, these are, if you want to say entropy here, it will be logs of these maps in the space of truncated polynomials. So I want to say the whole algebra is absolutely parallel to what we have in classical mechanics of Boltzmann, but I'm saying the Boltzmann could appreciate Mendel, yeah? Because Mendel is more general than Boltzmann. He kind of developed the same formalism, of course, in a baby form needed for him, but for more sophisticated probabilities. They're not numbers, but this rings of object and this ring of truncated polynomials. And this again, it's in Mendel's formulas. His formalism was exactly adapted to that. Of course, he writes somewhat differently, yeah? And so, the point, now I want to come to this, the theorem, this is just kind of what goes into the proof of what I'm going to formulate. So I want to formulate this theorem. Yeah, so far it was algebra, right? And now comes analysis, and this is a theorem. So you have these maps. Yeah, these are multiplicative endomorphisms, which I repeat how you get them. You restrict your polynomial to different kind of normal planes, splitting your space, and extend each of them, and then multiply. Right. So it's a polynomial map in the space of polynomials. Right. So you have this, and each of them depends how you have a set of indices, how you partition it. In each of them of this map is a retraction of the normalizing happily and the one which corresponds to probability sum equals one. Right? They project to corresponding Veronese type varieties. And so this is a very geometric map. They multiplicative endomorphism, and you know the images. And then you take the convex combination of such maps. And this is exactly what happens when how the genomes being formed for many genes. Yeah. Right. Now, it's really convex combination. These coefficients corresponds probability of exchange at a particular locus of a particular gene. This, of course, is just you have to look a little bit at that and see why it's just a reformulation of that. And once you do that, then the theorem says that this thing exponentially converges to equilibrium state. So equilibrium when kind of all components of rank one, those which are unchanged. Those which are unchanged are exactly kind of another way to say it, of maximal entropy. But now this maximal entropy, totality of that is not a number, but it's element of this truncate polynomial ring in a way, right? And there is one fixed point, and the reason kind of this theorem works, if you look at linearized map, it's just contracting map. And because invariant under scaling, if you contract at one point, right, and you scale invariant, it contracts everywhere. So it's contracting map. So this contraction near fixed point automatically propagates everywhere. And this is a kind of a, again, in a very common thing, of course, in dynamics, is everywhere. And I don't know if Mendel understood this, but this paper, this theorem of 20s, I think, quite old paper by these two people. So I never heard of their name before, of course. Then when I look at the literature, I found it. And what people do in genetics. So this is I think it's a very neat theorem, yeah. It's a map which is linearizable. So the point again, essentially you prove that certain map has a unique fixed point because it's linearizable by exponential map in the ring of truncated polynomials. And it's kind of very nice map. And so at this point I'll finish with that. And what I was here saying, in both cases, in for Neumann entropy and the discussion, that you can linearize thing, probabilistic thing, and then mathematics become much kind of more dimension, requires more dimension which are not at all explored. So, for example, this Mendelian dynamics, absolutely kind of untouched. If you look what people write, they still, after Hardy, use multiplication table. While it's obviously there is kind of an algebraic geometry which is underlying it, and there is much more something much more general. And if you think about what happens here, that it kind of engulfs many kind of general principles of probability theory. So, for example, the normal distribution law is in a way of the same nature, but very, very special form of this kind of theorem, right? So this kind of phenomenon, we have multiplicative endomorphism. In convex, we have algebra, some simple topological algebra. And we have this very special and important algebraic multiplicative endomorphism, and they're convex combinations. And they give you a very interesting class of dynamics, which dynamics you can understand. It's not kind of this mesh dynamics, which, you know, chaotic dynamics, which you say it, and then you kind of, it's pure for your satisfaction. For application, I can't understand it, so I can't. But there, exactly when you have very specific behavior, such as the normal law, which is again a fixed point of certain renormalization map. So this is a kind of renormalization in a way starts from Mendelian dynamics from this point of view. But then, my last lecture next time, I will be explaining next round of linearization. You can linearize it even further than what I said, and then it comes in topology and becomes associated with measures, and entropies will not enter them because I haven't arrived at this point, but there will be kind of measure theoretic view on certain topological and mechanical phenomena when linearization goes further and you think things become more symmetric. So from certain point of view, again, probability is enhancing the symmetry, and you can do it step by step, doing it more and more symmetric with more and more kind of consequences. Okay, for today it's finished. Oops.